Hello, Fuji Vyas. How are you? I hope you are doing well. So, friends, as you know, that on the channel we are covering the syllabus of UPSC Civil Services, and for that purpose, we have started multiple series on our channel that target your prelims as well as mains. So, friends, currently we have 12 series that focus on your prelims and one series that target your mains. So, what we do in these prelims-oriented series, we have basically divided your whole syllabus into 12 large subtopics, and what we do, we daily discuss two subtopics, and in this manner we cover your 12 subtopics in 6 days. So this process goes on and on in a cyclic manner, and we will continue to do so till 31st May. So why the date chosen has been 31st May? Because on 2nd June is your prelims of UPSC CSE 2019, and we will end this series only one day before your prelims exam. So let's start our discussion. So today is lecture number 7 of economy. So let's see what are the MCQs of today's lecture. The first question is, consider the following with reference to Niti Aayog. First, it hosts the Team India Hub, which leads the engagement of states with the central government. Second, it acts as a repository of research on good governance best practices. Third, it has been nominated as the nodal agency for bringing the sustainable development goals into action across India. So we have to choose the correct answer. Let me tell you that all of these statements are correct. So basically, it has two key hubs of Niti Aayog, that is Team India Hub and this Knowledge and Innovation Hub. So the responsibility of Team India Hub is to kind of lead the engagement between state and center, and also the purpose of Knowledge and Innovation Hub is to make Niti Aayog a repository of knowledge, so that it can guide the government in best practices relating to various policy measures. So the second is also correct. Regarding the third statement, friends, yes, it has been nominated as the nodal agency for bringing this as sustainable development goals into action across India. So the answer would be D. So here I have provided only the answer, and I have not included the explanation. Earlier we used to provide the explanation, but friends, we have now changed the policy. So in case you want the explanation PDFs of these MCQs, you can contact us on this email ID, that is achieveies21@gmail.com, or for that matter at this contact number, that is 8968426481. So there will be certain procedure after which you will be subscribed to the explanation PDFs. And if you want to know the quality of our explanation, you can check the previous lectures. But let me tell you, friends, that now these explanation PDFs will cost you some amount, but we have kept it as minimum as possible for the purpose of your affordability as well as for the purpose of our motivation. So in case you want to subscribe to them, you can contact us at the given email ID or at the given contact number. So let's move on to the second question. Second question is, when government expenditure is more than its receipts, first, it floats rupee in the international market. Second, it purchases sovereign bonds of credit-rated countries. Third, it increases the amount of current account deficit to fund the fiscal deficit. Fourth, it purchases securities under the market stabilization scheme. So we have to choose the correct answer. Let me tell you, friends, that when government expenditure is more, then it doesn't float rupee in international market. This is not correct. Rupee has no relation with this kind of thing. Regarding second statement, friends, the second statement is also wrong, because in case of purchasing of sovereign bonds of credit rated countries, obviously the government expenditure will increase, it will not decrease. So second is also not possible. Regarding the third statement, the government's expenditure is more, it increases the amount of current deficit to fund the fiscal deficit. This is let me tell you, friends, that this is also not correct, because it doesn't increases the amount of current account deficit. Fourth is also not correct, because this market stabilization scheme, it is conducted by RBI and not by government to manage the liquidity. So the answer is none of these. So the solution would be D. So explanation is in explanation PDF, in which case if you want to subscribe to them, you can contact us at this email ID or at this contact number. So let's move on to the next question. Third question is, which of the following measures may lead to an increase in the inflow of foreign exchange in India? First, devaluation of rupee. Second, stable and low inflation in India. So we have to choose the correct answer. Let me tell you, friends, that both of these statements are correct. So why the devaluation will lead to higher FDI? Because ultimately, if the devaluation of rupee takes place vis-a-vis dollar, so what will happen by the same investment in dollars, the foreign companies will be able to buy more Indian assets in rupee, because ultimately the value of rupee has decreased vis-a-vis your dollar. Regarding second front, yes, stable and low inflation encourages FDI because it leads to climate investment friendly environment. So the solution is C, both 1 and 2. Let's move on to the next question. Fourth question is, the TRIMS agreement sometimes seen in news is related to. So we have to choose that TRIMS agreement is related to first, domestic regulations over FDI, second, current account convertibility, third, trade balancing requirements of developing countries. So we have to choose the correct answer. Let me tell you, friends, the answer would be this TRIMS agreement is related to your domestic regulations over FDI and your this trade balancing requirements of developing countries. So 1 and 3 are correct. So the answer would be B, 1 and 3 only. So this solution is B. So basically these TRIMS agreement is related to trade related investment measures. So which are undertaken by different countries to protect the domestic industry. So this comes under your TRIMS agreement of WTO. So the answer would be B, that is solution 1 and 1, that is 1 and 2, 3 only. So next, let's move on to the next question. Fifth question is the poverty gap index measures. A, the proportion of population that is multidimensionally poor. B, the proportion of population that would be below the poverty line without positive state intervention. C, the proportion of population that is not employed in full-time regular jobs. D, none of the above. Let me tell you, friends, that the answer here also is D, none of the above. So basically, poverty gap index is what? It measures the kind of gap that is between the poverty of a particular individual and the poverty line. That is a baseline that measures poverty. So basically, when we do the headcount, when we use headcount index, we basically tell that this percent of population is under poverty line. So we do not make a statement, or we do not properly assess that what is the level of inequality in your this between below the poverty line. So this helps this poverty gap index measures the gap between the poverty line and the lowest one that is under poverty. So it tells us the condition, severity of poverty. So the solution is D. Let's move on to the next question. 6. Consider the following statements with reference to economic statistics over the past decade in India. First, the labor force participation rate for women has increased. Second, the size of the organized sector has increased positively. Let me tell you, friends, that the first is wrong, but the second is correct. So the answer here would be B. Solution would be A. So, B. So friends, here is a typing mistake. Please ensure that it is B. The organized sector has increased, but let me tell you that in fact the labor force participation rate of women has decreased due to multiple reasons. For example, rise in literacy of the women, which now spend more time for the education purposes, and also due to the economic well-being of the families, which discourage ultimately then the women working. So also other conditions like lack of safe conditions and this violence, physical violence or sexual assault, such type of things discourage women participation, and not so friendly environment for women in the labor market, because ultimately they have to suffer when they are pregnant. So obviously this discourages their employability. So the employers don't hire women. So solution is B, but not A. Here is typing mistake. Please note it. Let's move on to the next question. Next question is, special purpose vehicles often seen in news are related to. A, underwater observations in Arctic. B, military operations. C, willful defaults on bank loans. C, project investment and execution. Friends, the answer of this question is D, that is project investment and execution. So basically, special purpose vehicles are created to support the projects that are related to infrastructure, for example, financing of the infrastructure projects, or for that matter, or execution of the infrastructure projects. So these special purpose vehicles are especially for this purpose. Let's move on to the next question. Next question is, consider the following about rural public health infrastructure. First, primary health care centers must compulsorily be located in every village. Second, auxiliary nursing midwife is the first person who provides primary health care in rural areas. Third, primary health centers are capable of handling institutional deliveries. Let me tell you, friends, that we have to choose the correct statement, and only second and third statement is correct. First statement is incorrect. These primary health centers, they must not be compulsorily located in every village, because they have to be located in a region which which serves in minimum 30,000 population. So it is not necessary that in a village the 30,000 population must reside. So the first is wrong, but the second and third is correct. The answer here would be B. Solution is B. Let's move on to the next question. Next question is, Global Youth Development Index is published by A. Commonwealth Secretariat, B. United Nations Development Program, C. Carnegie Mellon Institute, and International Bureau of Education. So friends, let me tell you that the answer is Commonwealth Secretariat. So it is basically published by Commonwealth Secretariat to assess the condition of kind of employability and education and health related to the youth. So it focuses on the youth population. So the answer is A. Let's move on to the next question. Next question is, consider the following about external commercial borrowings. First, it forms a part of India's capital account. Second, it can be used by startups operating from India. Third, it can be used to finance only equity transactions of the companies. So here we have to choose the correct statement. Let me tell you, only first statement, first two statements are correct. Third statement is not correct. So it forms a part of India's capital account, and it can be used by startups operating from India. But let me tell you that external commercial borrowings, they come under the debt transactions of the companies and not the equity transactions. So the answer would be A. That is 1 and 2 only. So this is all about, friends, today's lecture. If you like the video, if you like the questions, then do hit a like to our video, and also please ensure that you subscribe to our channel, and also do not forget to press the bell icon, because then only you will get all the important notifications of the updates that we do on our channel. And in case if you want to subscribe to the PDFs, you can contact us at this email ID or at this contact number. So after following a procedure, you will be subscribed to the PDFs. And let me tell you that before you message us, that these explanation PDFs will entail some cost. So if you want to subscribe to them, you can contact us at this email ID, or for that matter this mobile number. So this is all about, friends, today's video. Do hit a like to it, and have a very nice day.